So that's where it's coming from with the idea. All right, paragraph 2. The beginning of the word of the Lord by Hosea, and the Lord said to Hosea, go, take him to be a wife of Corban, a servant of Corban, for the land has committed great Corban to pardon from the Lord. And to me, Anthony, he's a prophet. So God's man, and he tells you, go take a woman of Corban. He was well known in northern Israel as a prophet. And so it could be very apparent that he as a wife. And there's different opinions on if he was a harlot before he married her, or he picked her up probably like she went down the street on the road, she was pretty, and I'll say, okay, you're going to be my wife. There's different opinions. Some say she wasn't a harlot until after they got married, because of the burden of this, said, take a to be a wife of Corban. It doesn't say take a current harlot. So, and they say that, commentaries say that she compared to Israel, and that Israel had not gone away from God. So some say that if it was prior to their marriage or after their marriage, they told them they knew what was going to happen. So, so he went and took Gomer, the daughter of Gomer, which conceived in their hands. All right, all we know about her is her father was given. We don't know anything about him. We just know that she started out as a harlot and continued as a harlot. But they don't know what tribe she's from. She came to know us, so it's probably one of the 10 tribes that they got picked from. And one of the commentaries said that clearly this was an example, the whole story of Gomer and Hosea is all his parents gave him to the Lord God, because he loved God. So, they took that, and her name means continue or out all of Ahab's many times that people where they live to have to heaven. I mean, if the 70 heads were putting in front of the gates of the city, so people thought it happened to earth. And people would say, God, it's God calling, you know, he didn't give them the permission to take it that far. And that's why, and he did it more just to show that he was powerful than it was the other colonies out there. It was the pride of it all that God said, you're going to learn more. And Jeroboam is of the descendancy of David. He's of the house of David. And he's the last king. And then they go into captivity with the Assyrians. So that's the end of the house of David. Just like at the end of the house of Ahab, what David did, now we're going to have the end of the house of David. And it shall come to pass, five. And it shall come to pass at that day, I will break the bow of Israel in the valley of Calvary. And what that means is that because Israel has committed spiritual adultery and has forsaken God, he's going to get rid of the Jehu dynasty and he will be ended in the Israel kingdom because of going into captivity in the Assyria. That's what it means to break the bow of Israel in the valley of Calvary. So, and she conceived again. Notice, not by Hosea, but she conceived again and bare a daughter. And God said unto him, Hosea, call her name Lo-Ruhamah, for I will no more have mercy upon the house of Israel, but I will utterly take them away. All right, Lo-Ruhamah means no mercy or not love. This poor girl walking around. Okay, mom, a prostitute, and her name is no mercy and not love. Because the people that time were known exactly what they were doing. And also, in one place I saw it said, and it's a scripture or in the Bible, that Gomer's mother is also a prostitute. So, anyway, here we have number two child running around, not love, not fit. But I'm number seven. But I will have mercy. Wait, and Lohalah, for I will have no mercy upon the house of Israel, but I will utterly take them away. And this is what he's talking about here. But I will have mercy upon the house of Judah, and will save them by the Lord their God, and will not save them by bow, nor by sword, nor by battle, by horses, nor by horsemen. And this was because Judah had not yet fallen into apostasy. God was still going to be, have favor upon them. And that so he had to see them. And if you remember, what this means here, it says, I will not save them by bow, nor by sword, nor by battle, by horses. In the time, Judah was delivered in the time of Hezekiah, when the Assyrians were coming. The first one to Judah, Hezekiah called up the prophet, said, pray for us, pray for us. And because Hezekiah had first gone to God, God showed mercy. And that was when the Assyrians were surrounding Jerusalem, and the angel of God came that night and killed 185 of the Assyrian army. Wiped them out. And so the Assyrians didn't come back to Jerusalem for a while because they were so afraid of what was going on. 185,000 years is a whole lot. And that was only part of their army because they were kind of uprising in another part of, I think, Israel. And so Sennacherib had sent part of his army, majority of his army, actually, where this other rebellion was going on. And left the 185,000, so he said he thought this was more than enough to keep Jerusalem from being. That's what it's talking about when he was not going to do the deal that he was doing to Israel. He's going to have to fight. But then they go away in 722. That's when the Babylonians overcome Judah and Rahab in 70 years after. 8. Now when Judah knew Lo-Ruhamah, he conceived and bare a son. So it's still only this time that they would rest these 2 to 3 years. So we're talking about the whole time span of when she had these children certain things that are okay that will happen, but the Abrahamic covenant is unconditional. God promised that Israel would always be his people. Well, Israel and Judah at this point. All right, yet the number, so this is when God kind of turns his attention to comparison towards you. Yet the number of the children of him, yet the number of the children of Israel that you live as the sand of the sea, which cannot be measured nor numbered, and it shall come to pass that in the third day, the children of him, you are not my people, there it shall be said unto them, you are the sons of the living God. Then shall the children of Judah and the children of Israel be gathered together, and appoint themselves one head, and they shall come up out of the land. The day shall be the day of their joy. Alright, this is God saying, okay, at this point in time, you are not my people. I'm having no mercy on you, but it always did. Hold in compassion. And he says, there will, just like God told Abraham, the people of Israel, as he did with the sand of the sea, he's now continuing that promise. That there will be, it will be like the sand of the sea, but when they're taken to Assyria and they're taken to Babylon, there's still a remnant of the region. And the remnant of those are going to be like the sand of the sea. And he's going to say, when they come back to him, you are the sons of the living God. And why do you think that they're referring to here? Then shall the children of Israel be gathered exalted, but then they're unfaithful. They do not worship. You're supposed to be like, okay, if you do, you do it. Thank you. Therefore will I return and take away my coat and the crown thereof and my loins and the sleeve thereof and will recover my wool and my wool and my flesh, getting to cover her nakedness. Now God's going to take it away because they haven't returned him. And now will I discover her ruinous in the sight of the lovers and none shall deliver her out of my hand. I will also cause all her mercies, her faithfulness, her meanings, and her fathers, and all her fallen feet. And I will destroy her fallen and her feet whereof she has said, these are my rewards that my lovers have given me, and I will make them as a forest, and the beasts of the field shall eat them. And I will bring upon her the days of Balaam, and she burned incense to them, and she decked herself with her earrings and her jewels, and she went after her lovers, and the doctrine said the Lord. Okay, this is now God is saying, this is what's going to happen because he's having a confession. And I'm going to take everything away and tell you I'm that nature is going to be against you. I'm not going to allow the paintings or the hours to go because you're not going to have any more happiness, you're not going to have your deep things and moving in your status because things are going to be so bad and afraid and oppressive and not let you worship the way you think of them. And although we didn't completely, like I said, continue all this worship, it was kind of like the Pharisees. They did it, but it wasn't in the right frame of mind and not with the heart of God. It was just, oh well, you know, this is going to be our worship that we don't want to do. Thank you. understand, like, what are these people? But they would have direct thoughts. You can always explain it directly to God and then to the people. I think that's the way that they need to start. So I'm just going to recognize my community. Okay. Okay, and 16, verse 16. And so this is the restoration, this is the millennial kingdom he's talking about. And it shall be at that day, says the Lord, that thou shalt call me Ishmi, and shalt call me no more Baal. Ishmi is the terminology of Hebrew terminology for loving, wonderful husband, and Baal is Baal. Pretty mean, just like the God they are, but when the millennial kingdom comes, I'm going, and this is Israel, he's talking to Israel, but you are going to be my loving wife and I'm going to be considered for the Lord. And I will take away the names of Baal out of her mouth, and they shall no more be remembered, no more be remembered by a man. Thank you. come up and take them back, just like I left Israel and will take them back. We have to be that show Israel how I'm going to be for them. We have to be the sign. And what it means is that it looks to other guys and loves saving the money. They you put into relationships that they made and gave to as sacrifices to idols. So he goes and, you know, I guess there was probably an area that was possibly for so that, you know, just like my face, you know where it is. But people that want to know where it is to go to go. Whatever. So I'm sure he knew, and probably people told him, he's down there, you know, he wouldn't believe what's going on. So he went looking for it. He said, oh, my God. And he came down, yeah, I was with it 2 months ago. And he found it was there. So finally, he does find it. And it's not here, but extra difficult for the two on a slave car. But he either sold himself, pissed off into slavery because he owed debt, or that somebody that had been with her decided that he was going to sell her into slavery. And so he's sitting standing up on his auction block. And probably isn't, I would presume that he was going to sell her. She was very beautiful. She was beautiful and, you know, a nice looking woman. After years of college, I don't think. And but so the price of slaves is the general price of slaves is 32 cents a slave, is like $2 or $3. And but so I bought her for 15 pieces of silver and for a homer of barley and a half homer of barley. So he bought her back for 15 pieces, even though it was his watch. He bought her back for 15 pieces of silver. Encouraged what they do with this kind of woman is just trying to have her move. Gomer knew that this was going to be the situation. And he part of it, you get different people. And the image, you invite, you're 2 minutes late for the presentation. You're not serious, you're not on time.
Thank you.
Thank you. Let's get it.